Summit for Young Changemakers, the third year that we are kicking off this great event here in New Hampshire. My name is Will Stewart, and I'm the Executive Director of Stay, Work, Play New Hampshire, a statewide nonprofit whose mission is to attract and retain more young people here in the Granite State. Our primary goal for New Hampshire Next is to inspire young New Hampshire changemakers to create positive change in their communities and the state as a whole. One of the main benefits of events like this is the opportunity to meet other people who share similar passions. And while we wish we could meet in person, and fingers crossed, we'll be able to do that again very, very soon as we all get vaccinated. It's great that we have the option to connect virtually. So to that end, I'd like to invite you to introduce yourself down in the chat. Let us know who you are and where you're logging in from today. And I will say that we do have quite the lineup this afternoon to help kick off this week-long Changemaker Summit. Today, we're going to hear from three young people who are creating change, building community, and making an impact here in the Granite State through art. Before we begin, however, I'd like to thank Northeast Delta Dental, our sponsor for today's session. Without their support, this event, today's event, simply would not be possible. So to give a few words on behalf of Northeast Delta Dental, please welcome Courtney Morin, Vice President of Actuarial and Underwriting. Courtney.
Thank you, Will, and welcome everyone to Creating Change Through Art. Northeast Delta Dental is pleased to sponsor the third annual New Hampshire Next Summit and to kick off the week. At Delta Dental, we value strong community partnerships and encourage our employees to volunteer and give back to their communities. Despite the pandemic, last year, 42 employees were able to provide 4,332 hours of leadership to the boards and advisory committees of community nonprofits, some of which support the arts. The arts inform, inspire, and change both communities and individuals. Our president and CEO is a strong advocate of the arts, and we understand and appreciate what the arts contribute to New Hampshire's vibrancy. Northeast Delta Dental is proud to be a longtime supporter of Stay, Work, Play and its mission to attract and retain young professionals in New Hampshire like yourselves. Thank you to its many other supporters. Please consider helping us with your mission if you're not already doing so. The benefits to our state and our businesses will be far-reaching. Thanks, Will.
Thank you, Courtney. And thanks again to Northeast Delta Dental for your ongoing support of this initiative, the Changemaker Summit, as well as all of the other Stay, Work, Play initiatives that Northeast Delta Dental supports throughout the year. It is very, very much appreciated. And one more thing before we get started today, would like to ask a quick favor of everyone, and that is that we'd like to take a quick screenshot of everyone here today. So if I could ask you just for a second, if you wouldn't mind turning on your cameras and giving us a nice big smile. My colleague, Beth Sansusi here is gonna count us down for a quick picture.
I love seeing these faces. All right, guys, in 3, 2, and 1. Thank you.
All right, thank you all very much. Now, feel free, put your, feel free to turn your cameras off or leave them on, whatever you'd like to do. So now we'll get on here to the main event and what we're all here for, and that is New Hampshire Next. So today, you know, our speakers are here to tell stories about creating change through art. And after we hear from our speakers, we're gonna have time for a live Q&A. So feel free to send in questions in the chat as you think of them, or feel free to hold on to them and we can get to as many as we can at the end of our three presentations. So without further ado, let me introduce our first speaker today. And first up, we're gonna hear from Eliza Murphy, founder of Nova Arts in Keene. Eliza grew up in Nelson, New Hampshire, and now lives and works in Keene. She is the co-owner of Brewbaker's Cafe and Terra Nova Coffee, a small business that recently expanded to help launch an arts organization and music space called Nova Arts. Nova is a collaborative arts initiative focused on emerging artists, underrepresented voices, and unexpected juxtapositions. They present and partner with creative individuals, organizations, and ideas that aimed with the aim of having positive social and cultural impacts that ripple into the local community, but connect far beyond it. Eliza is also a teacher, painter, poetry maker, and mother who believes that art is for everyone and in everyone. Welcome, Eliza.
Thank you so much for having me, Will, and Stay, Work, Play, New Hampshire. This is a pleasure. And thanks for everyone who is here tuning in today. Nice to see you. My name is Eliza. Will, thank you for the intro. I can zoom through maybe the first of my slides, and I'm going to bring up a little presentation and just talk along and tell you a little bit about what NovArts is doing and where we're going. And here I go. So NovArts is, NovArts is, as Will said, we are in Keene, New Hampshire. It's a new space that has sort of evolved in the last year to become a big space, grew out of a little sort of a backroom DIY project, and is really all about partnering and presenting. What is Nova? Will just kind of gave you this one. So we're a collaborative arts initiative, and we are focused on emerging artists, underrepresented voices, and unexpected juxtapositions. We're all about presenting and partnering with creatives. And as Will said, I really think that we're all creatives, so that's a really expansive concept that we're partnering with creatives. That's kind of in all of us, and so we're really open to, you know, what people have to bring to the table and really interested in listening to voices that maybe aren't usually heard or don't usually have a platform. So I'm going to show you a little bit more about who we are and what we do and what we're about at Nova Arts, and then give you a little bit of background and history, because that background and history is actually kind of really our present. We're a new initiative in the last 2 years, I guess, and that this last year in the midst of all the upheaval has been our launch. So there's a story there that I'd like to share, and then I'd like to share a little bit about the artists and the performers that we're featuring and the partnerships and kind of where things are going. I'm not going to read you the mission, but I do want to be clear that we are mission-based. We are sort of principles-oriented as an organization. Our organization is connected to a small business, but is really a separate offshoot of it, and we've had an advisory board from the beginning that has helped us to clarify what our work is, clarify what our mission is, and keep us accountable to that, and that's really important to me. So, you know, our values about experimentation, accessibility, creative integrity, really drive everything that we do in curation and in conduct. So a couple of the things that we do, mostly these days we are presenting music. That's our sort of central work. We have an online platform that we've been using to present virtually. We also have a wonderful stage. So the stage is out of Brubaker's Cafe. We do ticketed events when it's safe to do so. I'll tell you a little bit more about that. We have live streams, and we're beginning to do community sort of jams, open mics. We haven't started that yet, but as soon as we can. But the music venue is a big part of what we do. We also have an arts education focus, so we have a partnership with an arts educator that is doing work with young students, after school kind of art, and adult creative hands-on opportunities for making art, and we're expanding that as well. We are a community space, very intentionally embedded ourselves in sort of an active community space. The cafe environment sort of deepens our capacity to build connections and to sort of seed and maybe incubate sort of some of the creative visions, the things that we believe are possible through the arts and through creativity. So we're lucky to be in a community space and to help facilitate that community space here in Keene. And we also have a very small press that is mostly digital these days. We have essays, poetry, and videos being published on our website. And we also have a small run of physical objects and graphic arts that we're working on expanding. So we have an advisory board that started in 2019. Sharon Fantel is one of our wonderful advisors who helped us to create the vision. She is from the Redfern Arts Center at Keene State College, one of the directors, and she's also a director of the Vermont Arts Council, and she's based out of Brattleboro. Eric Gagne, I think many of you may know him. He has been on in these events with y'all before. Eric Gagne is our program director. He is an old friend, wonderful resource, and Eric runs The Thing in the Spring and the Glass Museum in Peterborough, and he has a long history of presenting, booking, and curating, and he is now a big part of our organization here, and he's in Peterborough, and Sharon's in Brattleboro, and we're in Keene, and those of you who don't know where Keene is, it's in the southwest corner of the state, in a nice sort of spot in the middle of a lot of transit and a lot of passages, so it's a great place for a hub to be that's connecting to the east part of the state, north-south on 91 and into the center of the state via Route 9. And we're really kind of trying to live that there's a community that includes Monadnock region, but beyond it. Jessica Gilter, you all may know also, is the director of Monadnock Arts Alive here in Keene, and she does an amazing job supporting and shepherding arts organizations like ours. So Jess is one of our advisors and supports. Jeff Murphy is my partner, and myself, Eliza, we own the cafe and coffee roasting company that creates space for Nova Arts to exist. Caitlin is a tech wizard, and we have counted on Caitlin very much in the last year, of course, and Priya is our arts educator. We're lucky to have a great team that is growing. Our principles, again, I'm just going to read these ones because they are really important to us. Principles are access. All ages and identities are equally valued and welcome. Emerging, underrepresented, and marginalized voices are intentionally amplified. Experimentation. We believe in taking creative risks and being open to the unexpected. This can be true for audiences, artists, facilitators, and community. Collaboration. We believe in sharing resources of all kinds to enhance and strengthen community access and impact. The impact, this is a statement written by Eric. Nova seeks to open the community up to new sights, sounds, and experiences. By providing the opportunity to do so in accessible and exciting ways, we intend to not only lift up this community, but to connect it to a broader network beyond the Monadnock region. We feel that these connections encourage the growth of empathy, foster diversity, and can reinvigorate what engagement with the arts can and should mean in today's world. I'm just going to pause there and note that Eric and Jeff and I and Caitlin and many others grew up here in New Hampshire, and I think we really share the vision of stay, work, play, and have lived that and are living that through Nova Arts, which is to really give back, contribute, you know, create the community that we want to live in and that we want to share and like reach out to other folks and say this is a great place to be, and we want to make an impact, and we want a diverse community to be able to see themselves appreciated and represented here, and so we're really trying to create that kind of an environment through the work we're doing. So I'm starting now to just sort of tell you the story of where we were and where we are going. You can see this is literally a garage in the back of our little coffee roastery down in Keene on a sort of an industrial tract. And we had put our little coffee roastery in the back of this building a couple of years ago in 2017. And Eric and Jeff and I and some others would clear out the back room a couple times a month to put on little DIY shows booked by Eric through his kind of vast network of connections to artists and musicians. There were musicians, you can see, it really is a garage, but this was a really magical time. We'd sort of juxtapose a musician, a band with an artist pop-up, and just people from the community would find their way to us And it was wonderful. Homebody Dead Gowns from these guys. Homebody is from Western Mass, and Dead Gowns are from Portland, Maine. Here's we did a series of art pop-ups, like art fairs. So Molly Fletcher, she does really wonderful, like New Hampshire-based paintings. Yellow Clover and Billy Santilli were part of that art fair, the Last Minute Larry Arts Market, right before the holidays. I'm gonna play you a little bit because it was really, as I said, pretty magical, wonderful experience to put on these little shows back there. I hope the sound works for you guys. This is key to get it to work. And it is not playing a song, so I'm going to pause just for a second so that I can try to play this music. Can you hear this? There's a couple of things that were happening in the way back room. There's some really high caliber, amazing musicians coming through our little garage space. And we were then lucky enough to be able to begin to build out a much larger space. And you can see this started in the fall of 2019. And then right around the beginning of the pandemic was when construction was supposed to start. And incredibly, construction was able to continue. So you can see a little bit of what has happened where we expanded into a great big room. You'll see some more pictures of what that looks like in just a minute, but with the intention of having a home for Nova Arts, a stage and a sound system. We had a piano donated, really amazing work by many people. And so then we opened up in October of 2020 as a larger space. This is our opening weekend, and play a couple more pieces from that day. And play a little Riley again, because Weathermaker's Dance is one of my favorites. They're from Peterborough, I think. And Mike Puglio plays often on Saturday mornings and is presenting his own work shortly. That gives you a little feel for what it looked like when we were opening in the fall. We had a series of ticketed table reservations, live concerts in the fall. And here are a couple pictures of those. This is Charlie Chronopoulos, was our first event. And then this is Senny Hunt, who some of you may know, he's from Concord. And so these pods, you know, we were able to do a sort of a podding event. I'm gonna move myself just because I have to plug my computer in. Hold on just a second, so sorry. I don't want the computer to die in the midst of this. we were able to do that for a little while, and then carefully with lots of COVID restrictions and care and transparency, and then it didn't feel like that was the right thing to do anymore. So we, like many, moved into a live streamed way of presenting, and that was brand new to us. And so we sort of had to live our value of experimentation and learn how to do something new and believe that that something would come of it, and that it was a creative process. So we had a nice short lineup of in-person events in the fall, and then a long winter of live streamed events in spring. And so these are some of the names and a little bit about us going digital. This band is Editrix. They played just last Friday. Our live streams are available on our Facebook Live, and so it's free. And there's also an option to pay what you want for tickets, and donations to Nova are accepted. And one thing we really loved about the surprise, you know, need to go digital was that it really does make it more accessible for people in a lot of spaces and a lot of circumstances to check out the shows. So that was sort of a wonderful surprise. And also the donation model was really wonderful. We felt like people were really generous with the artists, and that felt great to see that at the end of this night there were audiences from all over the place and artists were getting paid. Here's a little picture of some of our after school art programming. Some happy kids. My daughter up in the right. The listening project is the small press I was referencing, that you can find it on our website and in our newsletter, essays by Eric Gagne or by others about music, personal history, and just really thoughtful invitations to kind of weave together ideas, cultural ideas, and art. Always a wonderful read. And we're looking for collaborators and writers to be part of that project going forward. Here we have our upcoming events. These are presented with the generous support of the Merrill Family Foundation. We also have a fiscal sponsorship now with Monadnock Arts Alive that is supporting our upcoming series and is allowing us to be able to accept charitable donations to continue to put on these kinds of events that are really open and accessible to all, and that are intentionally curating towards kind of diversity and unexpected and underrepresented folks. So if you go on our website, novaarts.org, you can find tickets or links to all of these upcoming events. Here are a couple of faces that we'll see shortly. False Whirl, Melodia Sack, Modern Fools with Arya Grace. Modern Fools with Arya Grace, I think, is one of the first ones back. We're gonna try doing a little bit of tabled, reserved, careful, potted on-site shows again. So that's really exciting. As I said, we are so grateful to the Merrill Family Foundation for being our first founding donor that's supporting the series going forward. And I just want to take a moment to invite anyone who maybe does have the interest in supporting the efforts of Nova Arts, and if the impact and principles resonate with you, we are very happy to talk with you about how we could support you. You could support us, we could support you in turn. Also, if you're an artist or a musician or a performer who's curious about we do, please just get in touch. Eric Gagne or I or Jeff Murphy would always be happy to chat with you, either by email or come on down to our spot. We just recently became marquee official, and the spot is really fun to visit. So here's our website, contact for Eric. Our address, we're in Keene. Sunny Hunt leading us out.
thank you, Eliza. That was great. And congrats on the new marquee. I think it looks awesome. And I know I think I speak for a lot of us when I say we can't wait to get over to Keene very soon and be able to check you out. Again, those in-person events are going to become, I think, a lot more realistic very, very soon. So thank you again for sharing the story of Nova Arts. Super, super cool. So next up, we are going to hear from Deo Moano and the work he is doing with the Blueprint Project, which you might have heard about a little bit. We're going to get kind of the some behind the scenes insider information. But before that, let me tell you a little bit about Deo. Deo Moano is a social impact innovator whose work is focused on education, technology, business, community, and individual development. Deo earned his BA in International Relations and History and an MBA in Strategic Leadership. He has worked for the US State Department, nonprofits, educational institutions, and tech startups. His honors include being named to the Union Leaders 40 Under 40 class of 2016 and a member of the Leadership New Hampshire class of 2017. Working with organizations nationally and internationally, Deo is a sought-after speaker, program designer, community builder, and performer. Today, Deo operates Deo Moano Consultancy, through which he offers speaking and training opportunities and creates engaging empowerment content. Welcome, Deo.
Hello, thank you, Will. Thank you for that introduction. I am going to try to get everybody into this world that I've been living in for the last 5 months, which is part of the Blueprint Project. So if you can hear me and I'm clear, just give me a thumbs up or something to make sure that everything is good on my end. We're going to kick off by, I'm going to share the blueprint, just a small little teaser of the Blueprint Project, and then I get to unpack it a little bit more for you. So thank you, everybody that's been able to attend this presentation virtually. So let me share my screen, and if you can see my screen, please give me a thumbs up. And what you're about to see is just a teaser. So this is not the entire project. So this is like a long trailer teaser thingy. So check it out.
Is in your life's blueprint.
Hi, this is Deo. I want to welcome you to the Blueprint Project. This is a compilation of stories that inspires and tells the different perspectives of different people's walk. But the important part is the inspiration of this project, which is Martin Luther King's speech on what is your blueprint that he made in 1968 in front of high school students. We've taken it, we've modernized it, and hopefully this is an inspiration to you with everything that's happening in our culture and our society. It's about coming together and overcoming our challenges and our difficulties. So I hope you enjoyed this video. Thank you so much.
Don't allow anybody to pull you so low as to make you hate them.
Yes, I did speak with management, and they have been looking at a few candidates outside of the company as well.
Jeez, man, it's so hard. I don't even know if I'm really engaging with them, you know? Like, I really just can't wait for things to go back to normal.
I know it's affecting everything, right? But listen, with all this that's going on, the company, they had to let me go, babe. I got laid off. You're only defeated if you allow. You can fall, you can fail, you can bend, but just don't break. Leave your past, leave your mistakes. Yesterday will fade away. Just let go and face today.
No. I'm working two jobs right now. You can't give me an extension or something? Why not? Oh, all right, look, I'm at work. I can't talk right now. I'll call you guys another time.
I know. I want to get home sooner, too. I miss you and the kids.
I know, but the school needs to be disinfected. It's COVID. We can't have an outbreak.
Just be a trail. If you can't be the sun, be a star. For it isn't by size that you win or you fail. Be the best of whatever you are.
I'm at my daughter's school. I'm about to pick her up right now. What do you need? No, I can't come in. I just worked two doubles. That's not safe. No, I'm exhausted. Okay. Yeah. Yep. I'll get her. I'll go home and change and then I'll come in. Okay. All right. Bye.
Has always devalued Black bodies, has never seen Black people as worthy of protection.
Nah, fam. Yo,
if you
can't
look around today, those same protesters are still on the ground, reimagining what justice should look like.
I feel like Martin Luther, I'm a king. 2020, better give me my rings. Ringing the bell, let me let freedom ring. Sweat jersey was right, it was never the same. Little homie, let me give you some game. Just learn to supply when you see the demand. Wisdom is sweet, learn to live off your pain. Just polish your gift, it was always your gym.
Yeah. It's like freaking ridiculous. I don't want my face to be plastered on the internet just because I'm in class.
Don't allow anybody to cause you to lose your self-respect to the point that you do not struggle for justice. Human nature cannot be cataloged. They in their own lives have walked through long and desolate nights of oppression, and yet they've risen up and plunged against cloud-filled nights of affliction, new and blazing stars of inspiration. If I were so tall as to reach the pole, or to grasp the ocean at a span, I must be measured by my soul. The mind is the standard of the man.
All right, so that's a little, just a little sneak peek into this project that I put together back in. It started off in November, and what really contributed to this project for me was kind of the environment that we've all been in within the last 12 months, within the last year. And for me, I wear many hats, and I get to engage and interact with people on a consistent basis. And part of my work, it really focuses on relationship building and helping organizations solve problems, helping people figure out how they can better understand each other. And so with the COVID, I was kind of in the front line with many different organizations, consulting and working, helping with the community and doing different things. And I started to reflect on that. And as I was reflecting on it, I started to realize that, holy crap, there's a ton of different things happening here. And from a creative standpoint, I said, I wonder if I can like capture these different stories, but then create a different outlet for people to be able to express the frustration, the pain, the anger, all the different emotions that might be, you know, held inside them, and they don't have an outlet to be able to share it out. So that's where the idea of the blueprint started coming about. And it was probably around, I would say, end of October, beginning of November, but I didn't really know how I was going to bring it alive. So a lot of my work, there's like three focuses of my work. I do a lot of work with workforce, so businesses that are trying to, you know, create employee culture, and lately, it's been a lot of diversity, equity, and inclusion work. And then I work with education institutions. So I've been working with this one district even prior to COVID and then into COVID, there was a lot of stuff that came up where it started to elevate some of the challenges students and teachers were facing. So a lot of that stuff actually inspired some of the story that it's part of the blueprint. And then with the community, I'm super, super involved in the community where I live. I'm plugged in with different things. So I take all those three kind of buckets of the work that I'm involved with. I started to think about, okay, how do I bring this to life? And then within the last 12 months, I mean, everything has been remote for me. I the space that I'm in, how I'm presenting to you right now, this is how I've been doing all of my work. But I wanted to create a space where it allowed some of my friends and collaborators that I've worked with to come together and be able to bring hope and bring motivation and inspiration through these stories. So the first picture that you're seeing, this is literally where the project started. So I was working with Dairy Field School for a project. I was like a visiting fellow, whatever you want to call it, with Dairy Field School in Manchester. And part of that was I was going to be doing some training for the students, but also coming up with this school-wide initiative. So a couple of years back, I did a presentation around the blueprint. It's a Martin Luther King speech that was made in 1967 at a high school in Philadelphia. So I've always held on to that speech in the presentation that I did 3 years ago. And I wanted to go back to that presentation because it talks about everybody having their own personal blueprint. And I thought, wow, what a perfect timing, especially with everything that's happening right now, to go back to that, right? Grounding, what is your personal life's blueprint? And how do you want to show up for yourself, but also show up for those who are around you? So when I started to focus on that concept, I reached out to different collaborators that I knew in the city. And I said, hey, I want to work with an art student to come up with this graphic regarding this project that I'm working on. Ended up being a student at New England College campus in Manchester, which used to be formerly NHIA. And the student, she got on the phone with me and said, hey, I have this idea. And I saw some of your work. I like your work. Just go and just do whatever you want. So she ended up coming back with this image. So this is what you're seeing. And if you look carefully, there's writing, there's little messages in there. And I was like, oh man, this is their starting point. And then I went back to her and I gave her the silhouette that you see with me standing with the microphone. It was a presentation that I did in Boston in July. There was a demonstration there. And I gave her that. I'm like, listen, instead of having, usually when you see in a graphic like this, you know, there's strong words around. Can you put this like alliance, solidarity, dignity is humanity, be resourceful? She's like, all right, I'm going to plaster it all over the graphic. So this was the second version of the graphic. So this became the driver for what inspired what the project was going to be for me. So as I started to think about the Blueprint project, I started to think about the different partners and communities and organizations that I've worked with in the last 12 months. And I started to think, what are stories that I can capture from those experiences in order to bring it to life? So the first story, so the first aspect of the project was, I thought about the character. So I identified 8 different characters, and then each character had its own story. So one of the character is a student who is dealing with anxiety with remote learning, turning her camera on because she realized that a lot of her friends they've been bullied by them going on camera. So what was happening was they would take a screenshot of her and it would turn into a meme. So she was scared of that. So that was one of the stories. And this was actually this came out of a school district that I was consulting with where the school board decided that students didn't have to turn their camera on in result of that. So I was like, I want to capture that story. Another story was a person who just got let go of work because, not because they did anything wrong, it's just because their inventory is super low and they don't have any money to continue to pay him. So you see him internalizing that. And then another one was an African-American student who is grappling with all these images and stories that are in the news with all this social unrest and he's feeling so overwhelmed by it, and he wants to do something in order to resolve it. So once I identify the stories, I wanted to make sure that the music were authentic and the music were you know, relevant to the piece that I put together. So we started I started to collaborate with different creators around the concept for the music. So one of the things that we did was I ended up reaching out to this orchestra teacher at Central High School, who is an amazing cello player. And we started to just like experiment to try to figure out how we can work together and come up with, you know, original music that could bring people together around this whole idea of the Blueprint Project. So I'm going to share just a little clip here, just behind the scenes, so you can see what it was like, kind of just sifting through and figuring out the right sound. So I'm about 4 minutes, almost done here. So what you're seeing here, he's playing live music and I'm using this beat machine. So all the music that you heard, most of the music that you heard from that project, this is how those music were created. Anyway, so that was completely just freestyle. We've never jammed together. This is the first time we ever came together. And the whole concept of this Blueprint Project, some of the footage that you just saw, it all came from just a collaboration of different creators in New Hampshire that I've created with, that I reached out and said, hey, I have this idea. I'm trying to bring this idea to life. Would you be interested to partner with me in order to collaborate and bring this to life? And one of the things that I realized during that partnership was giving people the freedom to decide how they wanted to bring the story to life. So I gave them a framework of who the characters were, but I allow them to really sift through and come up with their own version of who the character that they were playing. So the images that you're seeing are a little bit of behind the scene when we were shooting this was in a pandemic. Luckily, we shot it on the weekend at Deerfield School. A lot of the shots were shot there where there were nobody there, but it was a complete collaboration. And now we're actually bringing the project live for the first time. A virtual version of this will be this Friday, April 16th at 7:00. It's a partnership with Capital Center of the Art and the Bank of America stage. You can purchase your ticket online in order to see it. So each story is about 7 minutes long. So what you saw in the overview was just a high level of it, but it was really cool to see everybody come together and collaborate on this project. And thank you for taking time to hear me tell a little bit about the Blueprint Project. And if you're interested to attend the event, please come through and come check it out and we'll have a great discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Deo. And speaking of questions too, just a reminder for everyone who might have questions for any of our presenters today about their work, how they go about it, anything, feel free to throw them in the chat or you can feel free to hold on until the conclusion of our final presenter, who I will introduce right now. Last up today, certainly not least, however, we're going to hear from Manny Ramirez with Positive Street Art in Nashua. A New Hampshire transplant from New York City, Manny has grown up to love living, working, and playing in New Hampshire since 2003 and is an artist for all settings. Whether it's the dance floor, a brush or spray can, camera or computer, Manny has a talent for design and expression, and his passion for urban expression is what powers his creativity and craftsmanship. Welcome, Manny.
Thank you, Will. Thank you for that awesome introduction. Hello, everybody. Thank you for having me here. I'm going to talk a little bit about what positive street art is and kind of where we started and where we plan on going in the future. And I'll also show you guys a video. I have been in the middle of a pretty large project with the city of Nashua. So unfortunately, I don't have a ton of content, but I'll share and talk as much as I can. Basically Positive Street Art is a nonprofit organization started by myself and my co-founder Cecilia Ulibarri. We started this with the idea that we wanted to have street artists be more represented in communities and urban art being more a little bit in the forefront of art in general. And then so the very main idea was originally to have a free legal wall for artists to be able to paint and kind of share their art with the world, for people to be able to freely come and go and check out the art, and for the art to continue to change, and different artists to be able to express themselves on the go, and then for the art to continue to change weekly, daily, bi-weekly. So basically just a free wall. Little by little, we started to realize that there was more of a need in our community for that. And a lot of the key players in our community were interested in having us do more of educational workshops and sort of things like that on based on what street art is, what graffiti is, and some of the things, some of the parts of hip hop that people don't really understand. So we started with organizations like the Boys and Girls Club, the Police Athletic League, alternative high schools like Gateway here in Nashua. And then we continued on, and we started to realize that we could do a lot more with that. And so we decided to build a nonprofit. We went through the whole entire gamut that goes with starting a nonprofit, and threw ourselves into at the wolves, because we had no idea what a nonprofit was at the time and moment. So we learned everything that we needed to. We brought in other partners to join our board. Now we're basically a full running organization that deals with painting murals, a lot of artistic services, including dance workshops and that sort of thing. And we bring it to local community centers and schools as well. We have done collaborations with many Nashua organizations throughout the years. We've done performances for some government organizations as well. We've done a ton without kind of getting myself into just running without straight focus. Let me just, I'm gonna share a video that I have with you guys based on what the organization was. The video was filmed and edited a few years ago. I believe it was 2015. So it's a little outdated, but I'll be able to pick up the pieces where the video leaves off and kind of update on what we've been doing since then. So without further ado, I'll share some content with you guys. Right. Let's see. I'm gonna share my screen. Broadcast. Yes, start broadcast. All right. I hope that this is working correctly and you guys can see what I'm trying to share. And here we go.
PSA has become an example to other artists. It has become an inspiration, I hope, to a lot of emerging artists. I mean, I like the way that it inspires other people to do their own thing. To a lot of people who may not have thought of themselves as artists before, it's an opportunity to become something that they want to be.
Passion.
It is a mission of positive street art to inspire a passion for urban arts through community events, educational workshops, and artistic services.
Just sparking a fire.
Inspires to motivate your community to reach out, whether it's to volunteer, to explore new arts,
to open somebody's eyes,
to try new things.
So inspire to me is to help somebody do things or see things in a way that they never saw themselves doing.
Oh, yeah.
Activate dance mode countdown. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
A freestyle dance for a full product.
Who just want to learn how to dance, you know, and through participating in our street dancing programs, are becoming more comfortable with expressing themselves.
I feel like teaching kids dance is something that they can bring with them everywhere they go, and they feel proud of it.
It is the mission of Positive Street Art to inspire a passion for urban arts
in a productive way to build stronger communities through
artistic services,
community events,
and educational workshops.
And what happens next?
What happens next
is going to be a surprise for me and you, but I think it could take on just about any shape now. They've touched everything in Nashville, and I'm just excited to see which door opens next for us.
All right, I'm not sure. Can everybody hear me? Stop. There you go. So that was basically what Positive Street Art is. That I just checked the timestamp on that. I just realized that it's from 2014. So we have created a lot of work in Nashua that's open to the public since then. Too many for me to mention with us without taking the next hour and a half or so. So I'll just kind of try to summarize it. Ever since then, we continue to our dance workshops and art workshops. We have now a studio, a little small studio down on Main Street, which we right pre-COVID we had open to the public, and we had to close because it's too small for group gatherings. We have done possibly another maybe 10, 15 murals since then. One big project that we did this past fall, I believe, we joined the, I forget the name of the organization, Building on Hope, to rebuild all of PAL, the Police Athletic League here in Nashua. And what we did with them is, we did a big mural that went on the large elevator shaft that they built for the building. And I can share some pictures of that if you let me share my screen real quick. Let's hope this works. And then I'll do one more video. We have continued to expand on our dance workshops and with that whole entire initiative to revitalize PAL, we did a video showcasing our dancers and also the new space that they have all together. So I will share that with you guys as well. But let me just show you a picture of the mural that we did there. I'll share these photos with you guys. Here's one, and yeah, that's right outside of the elevator shaft. That's a side facing wall of that elevator shaft, and then there's also this one in the front end, the front end of it, which is the same theme, but it's a different character. There you go. And then now I'll share a video that showcases the rest of the space that that Building on Hope created for PAL.
My love, ooh, my love, ooh, my love, ooh, my love. A winner never quits, and a quitter never wins. I thought about what I wanted, and you were on my list. Remember where I was. Jumping
Yeah, so that was the video that we did for PAL to showcase. That was the video that we did for PAL to showcase everything they have going on now in their new space, which is amazing, and it makes it so welcoming to kind of accompany the team that they already have that is so welcoming and so good to the community that they're in. So we thought that it would be a great opportunity for us to be able to showcase their space and also showcase what our dancers are doing. If you saw, there's two logos on each side of the screen at the bottom. One was ours, the other one was EM. EM is Expressive Movement, and they are the dance company that we've been working with for the last 2 years or so to bring dance to our community here in Nashua. And we thank them so much for being able to partner with us. Actually, one of their leaders is one of our board members as well. His name is Jeff. So that's pretty much what Positive Street Art does in a nutshell. And as I was saying, with the logos, Positive Street Art, our logo, if you can kind of tell, there's it kind of represents a house or a home, and as well as a spray can is kind of like a house with a little bit of an edge. So what we initially intended for that was basically a home for street art and a home for public art. And so that's our main goal moving forward, is to being able to expand on that and move our small little studio into a large space. Pretty soon we're going to be starting a fundraising campaign to be able to finalize that goal. We finally found a space that works for us, and it's just a matter of time before we get there and we're able to share a lot more with our community. So thank you guys all for having me be here presenting. And thank you again, Will, for having me here and the rest of Stay Work Play.
Yeah, of course, Manny. Thank you for sharing, and to you and Cecilia for starting Positive Street Art, and it's had an awesome impact as we've seen. Want to remind everyone, we do have a few minutes for questions. So if anybody has any you want to throw in the chat, or feel free to unmute yourself and just ask directly. I will, maybe to all of our participants, ask a question. And Manny, you just mentioned getting ready to do some fundraising. I know Eliza mentioned, having like a fiscal agent and collecting donations. I'm curious to know from each of you, Manny, Eliza, and Deo, how do you fund, the work, the artistic work that you're doing? It's nothing happens for free, and we need money. Money isn't needed for everything, but you do need money for some stuff. How do you go about making all this happen financially?
So for us, we've been lucky to have been one of the organizations chosen by Boston Billiards, and being part of the charity gaming initiatives. And so for the last few years or so, that's been one of the main revenue generator for us. And then on top of that, what we do is we do a lot of services, sort of like painting murals for different companies within the community. So part of that money goes back into the organization so that we can use it for our general revenue fund to be able to provide our programming. So that is it mostly. And then some small grants that we've received in the past.
Very cool. Eliza, how about Nova?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think it's one of the questions we sort of started to set out to try to begin to resolve, because one of the things that's really true is that a lot of organizations like ours kind of rely on commercially viable acts where they can sell a lot of tickets or maybe selling alcohol. So those are things that we didn't want to have to focus on. We wanted to be able to really curate and present and be an all ages space and curate and present, the range of artists that without necessarily relying on them being big ticket sellers. So yeah, it's a great question. One of the sort of concepts we're working with is collaboration and sort of the sharing economy. So, you know, Brubaker's and Terra Nova is really kind of being a benefactor and offering space to Nova Arts. But Eric and the folks at Monadnock Arts Alive and myself are working really hard on getting a model up and running with, you know, memberships and donations and sponsorships and underwriting to get that, to get these series is kind of up and off the ground and hopefully get some momentum. So, once we have some momentum, there's a good chance, you know, these artists do deserve to be paid. And I think people will see that once we kind of put them on the stage.
Yeah, absolutely. Deo, how about the Blueprint Project? How did you make that happen?
So with the Blueprint Project, I initially kind of, I front-ended the cost because the collaborators that I work with on the project, they're amazing, talented folks in our community. And I believed in it so much where I was like, all right, let's get this going. And obviously they gave me a discounted price for the time that it took for the videographer to edit and for them to show up on a weekend. And the cool thing about how I integrate arts into my work, I work with a lot of for-profit organizations. So when they bring me in, sometimes I'm able to upsell them, you know, a project that where I'm like, okay, we can do this typical way, right? End up with some PDF and you pass it around, or we can take an artistic approach where I can bring in some amazing artists that I've worked with in order to bring this to life. Sometimes organizations have a little bit of more budget to do stuff like that. But with Blueprint, the show that's coming up this weekend, virtually this Friday, we're hoping that we get a good turnout. And, you know, but for the most part, it's for me, I think with art, it's so interesting because, you know, you don't want to minimize people's value and what they have to offer. But then at the same time, as me as a full an artist myself, like I'm constantly looking for opportunity for collaborators that I work with to be able to plug them in with other opportunities. So with Blueprint, I had to front end that. So hopefully as I'm having more opportunity to showcase it, the funds that come in, it gets to kind of close the gap. But yeah, the good thing is, you know, from Manny would tell you this, you know, when you're collaborating, it's like when you're internally, you know, other creators is one thing, but when it's front facing, you want to make sure that you get funded properly for your talent, for your work. So that's always kind of the struggle, but hopefully, you know, people continue to think about the art, especially during this COVID time.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I definitely think, I mean, you know, Deo, you mentioned, you know, kind of the virtual presentations, and we've seen a lot of that. I mean, we're in that medium right now, and it definitely has evolved, and people have had to get creative on a number of fronts, and that includes being able to showcase and share that creativity, certainly. Manny, we did have one question come in for you in the chat. Jennifer Locke says directly to you, wow, these are fantastic projects and programs. Has there been any consideration of bringing any of these to a bigger statewide scale?
Yeah, so we've done some smaller collaborations outside of Nashua. And yeah, there's definitely, as long as all the stars align, then we're more than open to be able to go outside of Nashua and other communities, even outside of the state as well, as far as we can reach. It's just a matter of having the right amount of people behind our team and that the funding is there as well, because it's very important to being able to put together a project efficiently. So.
Awesome. Well, again, we do have a few extra minutes. If anyone does have any questions for any of our presenters today, I'll kind of open the floor. Feel free to just unmute yourself and ask away. Well, if people are still thinking, I'll go ahead and ask another question. I always have quite a few. I'm curious to know from each of you, to other, creatives here in the state or others, who might be in attendance today watching, or we're also recording this, might be watching it down the line. What advice would you have for others who are looking to launch their own projects, whether they're, starting their own organizations like some of you have, or, kind of one-off individual projects? What have you learned doing this type of work in New Hampshire, and what advice would you offer from a lessons learned type of perspective? Don't all jump in there at once.
All right, so I'll go first. So I would say just go for it. If you have an idea, start it yesterday. I mean, it's right now, I think COVID taught us all, like, it's never too late to start something, and or it could be too late. I mean, something like that could happen to you, and then you're all of a sudden, all your ideas that you wanted to do could go down the drain. So don't waste any time, just go for it, start it. I guess network as much as possible to see what avenues and opportunities are out there for you. I think that the most important thing is to start and continue. Don't get discouraged because obviously we're going to start our whatever our big idea is, and it may fail. So it's just a matter of being able to pick up the pieces and continuing on. That would be my two cents. Just start.
For sure. Eliza, Deo, any thoughts?
Sure. I can jump off on that one. I think somebody gave me the advice once that if you think you need to make a change now, you're still going to kind of need to make that change in 5 years. Like, if you know it now, if you're feeling it now, don't wait. Start. It'll just be 5 years later, and you'll still be, kind of yearning for something. And for a lot of us, we're yearning for something that kind of lives in that spark that you feel it. At different times, a lot of us feel it around art. It feels alive. It feels like a spark, and just, trust it and believe in it. And the other piece of advice that I got that was really great during this process was to think about the element of time, like use the element of time to your advantage to just as a key thing. Like, it doesn't need to look whole and complete right off the bat. Think about what your project is as a living, growing, changing thing over time, and doesn't need to start in any shiny way. Just start.
Yeah, I think for me, I'm a big believer that we're all creators, right? We all have a creative being that lives with us, that we just need to be able to tap into it. And I think there's two different things between perfection and just creating, right? And I think most people are afraid to put their stuff out there because they're afraid that it might not be good enough. But the starting point is just having the freedom to just explore and engage. And I know a lot of creators that sometimes, they might not even jump onto something because, the opportunity is not there yet, or the stars don't align. I mean, the stars sometimes are never gonna align. I think it's important to be able to channel that. And for a lot of my creation process, I believe in the process. Like, I don't believe in perfection. I believe in the process. And, everything that you saw with the blueprint, it was a complete collaboration. And I even mistakes that happen along the way, I'm like, all right, it's okay. I mean, this is, it's part of that exploration. So I would encourage you, whatever creative avenue that you feel passionate about, or you feel a yearning inside of you that you haven't engaged with, to really carve out the time to be able to engage with it and just explore. And then through that, you'll figure out what pathway that you can take to a greater scale that you can take and present it. But I definitely encourage you to just explore. You got to have that childlike mindset when it comes to creativity, where you just go make a mess, just create. It's not going to sound right. It's not, the video is not going to look right. The singing might not be on tune, but just go and do it.
Great advice all around. Cassandra Mason asks, who are your mentors? You want to start with that one, Deo?
In the creative space, So locally, I have collaborators. So one of my good friends, Shaquille Worsley, we've been dancing together since we were in high school, since we were 15 years old. So, and he's traveled with me all over the country, and we still do stuff. He actually played the teacher in the video. He was doing the breakdancing move. So I'm constantly collaborating with him on different stuff. So from a local standpoint, and then anybody else, like, I mean, Manny and I, we haven't fully connected yet, but we've been trying to connect ever since I've seen his stuff. I'm like, Manny, we get like anybody in the state, like Amanda, who you saw in the video. She was the art laureate for the state of New Hampshire. I don't know if I'm saying it right, but we finally had an opportunity to collaborate last September through the New Hampshire Humanities Gala. We came together. So to me, like, my inspiration and mentor in art, it's everyone. It's the canvas. It's people that are trying it. It's the YouTube. It's whoever. And I think I don't really look for approval when it comes to, you know, is this good enough, right? Like, and that's the thing that's differentiated me over the years. Like, I grew up teaching dance for a very long time. Like, I've taught dance for a very long time. And then I stopped teaching at studios because I realized that dance is part of who I am. Dance is not like, what do I do for a living? So in the art space, like, I protect that space. I'm not looking for someone to be like, oh, that wasn't good. Oh, you could have, you know, like, critiques are good, but I'm not looking for, like, I don't know how to explain it. Like, art's like, I don't know, like, I dance with my kids every day, right? Like, every day is part of what we do in my house. We dance, we rap, we do all that. So I just think that where you find your inspiration is really important. And for me, I find inspiration from everyone. Like, even right now, I'm looking out my window and there's American flag just waving back and forth. Like in my head, I'm like, oh man, I wonder what tune, what music can I make to that wave? Like, then I might dance to it. So, like, I don't know. It's a sacred thing for me. And I think that's why it gives me a little bit more peaceful process to just be like, all right, just go and explore. Anyways, I don't know if that was the right answer or not, but that's just where I'm at.
That's perfect. Eliza, how about you? Any mentors come to mind?
Yeah, you know, I probably my first love is dance also. So I will say that, you know, going way back to being a kid and there's somebody named Kristen Leach, who's now one of the directors of the New Hampshire Dance Institute, which dances with kids in schools and just makes it really accessible. She was there as a sort of a young dance teacher when I was also a kid. And just having, you know, having somebody who sees a kid and sees the spark and says, yes, let's do this. I had her and I had others, and she still inspires me in her work and community. And I've had just been really lucky. I do value mentorship, I think, not for approval, but for conversation and for just, you know, taking seriously the creative spirit and the creative questioning that comes along with it. And I've got some great, great folks in this area. Craig Stockwell's a painter who opened up his studio to me recently and just kind of he was my mentor, and I couldn't even believe the generosity of some of these folks. And I guess that's part of what I want to be able to give back.
It's awesome. How about you, Manny? Anyone come to mind as who's mentored you over the years?
So for me, I'm gonna use the quote, it takes a village. Back in about around 2009, and 2010, I moved back from college into Nashua, and I had an idea, or had ideas of what I wanted to do with my life. And I think from that point on, I've had an immense amount of mentors who kind of saw a spark in me and wanted to kind of guide me in the right direction and help me get my ideas out and into the physical world. I have a lot of mentors. Like, even my wife is a mentor. Like, I have a lot of people who have been able to, like, shape me who I am today and continue to believe in me and support me in one way or another. And then, yeah, like, having conversations with people like that, like Dale mentioned, is not really for approval or anything like that. It's just kind of like to have, I don't know, so I guess somebody else who shares your creativity or your passion to be able to kind of like work things through kind of make an idea from what you see it in your head to a fully functional, well-oiled machine, if you will, like a full function piece, whether it is in the dance floor or whether it is out on a mural or something like that, or an event, a local event. So yeah, I think that I owe a lot to a lot of people here in Nashua and abroad for their mentorship and support throughout the years. So yeah.
Well, thank you. Yeah, like you said, it it does take a village, and none of us gets where we are. You're kind of in isolation and without others. So it's definitely always good to hear, excuse me, from other people as well. So we are coming to the end of our time together today. So just want to thank all of you for joining us and sharing your stories and presentations. So Manny, Eliza, Deo, thank you for sharing all of what you're doing. All the creative endeavors, giving us an inside peek of kind of how it all came to be and the process. And Deo, I agree with Cassandra. Love the concept of process, not perfection. And I think that is kind of what it's all about. And to just get started, like all of you said, if you have an idea, if the spark is there, just go for it. It's not going to be perfect. There is no such thing as perfect. But to get it out there, that's where it all begins. So thank you all too for everyone who was able to join us today to watch. I hope it was inspiring, and I hope you take something from it and will go forth and likewise be creative and start something here in New Hampshire. Here at State Work Play, we love to facilitate discussions like these and to help make connections, and we hope that we were able to do that for you today. And if you're not already registered to join us for the rest of the week's sessions, we definitely invite you to do so. Tomorrow, Tuesday, we're going to hear from some young local elected officials here in New Hampshire who are improving their towns via public policy and advocacy in our Creating Change Through Advocacy Day. Wednesday, we're going to hear from some young people who are working to make our communities more anti-racist, more welcoming, and more connected in creating change through community. Thursday, we're going to hear from young people here in the state who are creating positive change by enhancing our state's food systems and outdoor natural resources in creating change through the environment. And finally, on Friday, we're going to wrap up in hearing from past Rising Stars winners about where they are now, what they're doing, and how they're continuing to make an impact here in New Hampshire in continuing the change. So my colleague, Sarah Davis, who is putting all of this together today and doing a great job, is going to throw the link in the chat for anyone who might not be registered for this week's upcoming sessions. Also, we'll throw a link in the chat to the 2021 Rising Stars Awards, nominations for which are now open. So we would encourage you to think about any young people you know here in the state who are making that positive difference in a variety of different categories and topics. Please nominate them for the 2021 Rising Stars Awards. And lastly, want to thank again Northeast Delta Dental, our sponsor for today's session. Again, without their support today simply would not be possible. So thank you again to Northeast Delta Dental. Also, thank you again to all of you for taking part today. We certainly hope that it was worth your time. Please keep an eye on your inbox and social media for upcoming Stay Work Play events. And with that, thank you. Have a great day and hope to see you tomorrow again at 12 noon.